The next presentation will be given online by Julien Chabet from Observatoire de la Côte d'Azur in France. The presentation is Downlink Communication Experiment with Osiris V1 Laser Terminal Onboard Flying Laptop Satellite at Grass SLR Station. Julien, we don't.
The downlink communication experiment with the Osiris laser terminal at Grass SLR station. It was a collaboration between us, SigmaWorks, the French Space Agency, the German Space Agency, and the University of Stuttgart, the Institute of Space System. So it is not the first time we do a laser comm experiment at Grass SLR station. The first one was in 2014 with the SOTA payload on the Socrates satellite. The second one was using the OPALS payload from NASA on board the International Space Station. And the most recent experiment we did was on Osiris at the end of 2018. And I will talk about the next experiment at the end of the talk on NORSAT TD from satellite from Norway. The Osiris experiment was done with the flying laptop satellite. It's an open loop body pointing satellite. The data rate on board the satellite is 200 megabytes. In this experiment, we had new challenges for the MEO telescope. We had to move from the NASMIS focus to the Coudet focus to add more detection channel and to emulate three telescopes of 50 centimeters diameter. We used the tracking and pointing upgraded for fine tracking and coarse tracking. We use also telecom detection upgrade from 10 megabytes to up to 1 gigabyte per second. And also we use the telecom signal recording at 3.2 giga samples per second. And some of the channels were used to do some atmospheric characterization and to add adaptive optics system using the LISA bench the ONERA team in order to test fiber coupling with adaptive optics at telecom wavelengths. So the Osiris bench has at the Fouquet as a Coudet focus, sorry, has several channels. For that, we use 19% of the laser beam toward tetrahedral beam splitter in order to generate three sub-aperture channels of diameter 50 centimeters. One channel was for the telecom detector. Another one was for the wavefront sensor, Shackartman analyzer. And the last channel was for the adaptive optics for fiber coupling. 10% of the light is sent to a tip camera in order to control the tip-tilt mirror to stabilize the laser. So my colleague A has already presented our system of combination of coarse and fine auto-tracking. The telescope is doing the coarse tracking and the tip-tilt mirror is doing the fine tracking. And during the experiment with Osiris, we managed to position the laser within 1.1 arc second RMS on the detector field. In this experiment, three ground stations were involved. Our station at Grasse and two stations in Germany. One fixed station with 40 centimeters diameter and the mobile station from DLR with 60 centimeters aperture. We have some results on the optical flux received at the stations. On the left, you have the flux received at Grasse SLR station, and on the right, at the DLR station. We have found a similar behavior on the received laser flux in France and in Germany. The maximum optical power levels detected at optical ground station do match with the theoretical link budget. But we have seen some beam wander from a pointing error causing a frequent fading. This fading is caused by body pointing offset of the satellite. We were also able to measure bit error rate. So this is on the left some examples of the data collected at Grasse optical ground station. And we were able to measure this bit error rate as a function of the optical power on the photodiode. On the right, the red dots are the data collected during the Osiris pass. And the blue line is the data collected in the lab during a test. And we have a good agreement between the two. We did also some atmospheric channel characterization. So you all know the effect of atmosphere by atmospheric attenuation. We have also background noise. But we looked at the effect of atmospheric turbulence caused by wind and temperature gradients. This will generate beam spreading, beam wandering, scintillation, and wavefront distortion. For that, we use on one of the channels Shack-Hartmann analyzer, a wavefront sensor, to measure the local slope of the incoming laser beam using an array of micro lenses. And from this, we can extract the radius of coherence of the turbulence and the so-called Fried parameter. We also use independent instrumentation. We use a generalized differential image monitor. It's a small telescope equipped with three subapertures. And by looking at the differential motion of the star on the camera, we are able to extract the turbulent parameter, the Fried parameter, the scintillation index, the isoplanetic angle, and the outer scale of the turbulence. And the last instrument we use is a CN² profiler. It's a telescope equipped with two subapertures to look at the edge of the moon or the sun. And by measuring at two different points, the differential motion of the edge, we are able to extract the strength of the turbulence at different altitudes and have a profile of the turbulence every minute with a resolution of 100 meters in the ground layer. This is an example of some data acquired by this instrument during the day on the sun and during the night on the moon. And we can compare the data with the data measured by the differential image monitor below. During the Osiris experiment, the trajectory of the satellite was close to the moon. So it was a good opportunity to compare the data from the Shack-Hartmann analyzer with the data from the Moon LIM profiler. And this is what we have found on the Fried parameter as a function of time during the Osiris pass. The dark square, the black square, are the data from the Shack-Hartmann analyzer. And the green line is from the differential image monitor. And the red and black line are from the sin square profiler with a small difference on the black line because we have to use a ground layer correction because of the topography of the observatory here on the right, and we are able to reach to see the little discrepancy between the Shackartman and the sin square profiler on the right. We also looked at the scintillation of the intensity on the detector for telecommunication. This is during the pass the power received at photodiode and the scintillation expressed as a variance of the intensity over the intensity squared. And this is compared to the evaluation from the profile of the CN square. And we have again a good agreement between the two. Next, in 2003, we will have an experiment with the NORSAT TD satellite. This satellite will have a small communication active terminal called SmallCat for experiment with laser communication. And there will be also a laser reflector. There is two tests on this satellite. Satellite collision avoidance system developed by Fugro. And there is also a iodine-fueled electric propulsion developed by a French startup, Trust Me. So there is a lot of interesting things on this satellite, looking at the orbit of the satellite. So the scientific team of the mission will contact the governing board of ILRS for a request to track the satellite by the network. So in conclusion, this is the third successful telecom experiment at CRAS SLR station. The downlink budget is in good agreement with the German observation and the theoretical evaluation. We were able also to measure the real bit error rate. It was limited by the photodiode sensitivity. We also performed a good evaluation of the atmospheric turbulence effect by independent instrumentation on the wavefront distortion and on the scintillation. And this opened interesting studies on the ultimate performance of continuous laser ranging or very high rate system, and also coherent laser beam time and frequency transfer and orbitography. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Julien. Is there any question in the audience? Okay, a question from Tom Varghese.
For gigabit laser communications, how much is the, what is the impact of atmospheric turbulence? And can we manage with tip-tilt refocus, or do we need Shackartman?
Okay. To do this data collection on the photodetectors, we only used the tip-tilt mirror. This helped to kill 70 to 80% of the turbulence, but it's not enough for single mode fiber injection. And for this, you need to use a complete adaptive optic system, a deformable mirror, and for that, you need the Shackartman analysis.